This program is proudly brought to you by ComCopy, the duplicating specialists. Welcome to In Between the Sprockets, a movie and video review show with a bent edge. I'm Madeline Swain, and as you can see, we've gone a little bit more informal for our last show of the season in preparation for our summer holiday. Oh, that sounds like a good title for a movie, doesn't it? We're down here at St Kilda Beach, spitting the grass out of our sandwiches and looking out for passing Frankie Avalon and Annette Funicello lookalikes. Haven't seen any yet, though, have we? Yeah. In this week's show, we'll be looking at the new film from Atima Gwyn, Exotica. We'll also be looking at Young Poisoner's Handbook. And we'll have an interview with the director of that film, Benjamin Ross. We'll be giving the final roundup of the picks and the pans of the Toronto Film Festival. Oh, and our video review is that very charming, sweet vacation film that never features a single speck of sand, incidentally. Summer Holiday with bachelor boy Cliff Richard and his chums. But first up, let's get down and dirty at the sleaziest club in town, Exotica. Exotic, put your hands all over my body, exotic, and all that sort of stuff, you know.
Everybody knows that you love me, baby. Everybody knows that you really do. Everybody knows that you've been faithful. God, give or take a night or two. Everybody knows you've been discreet, but there were so many people you just had to meet without your clothes. And everybody knew.
The action of Exotica takes place around the twilight world of a tabletop and lap dancing nightclub. Now, it's one of those films that features a wide range of seemingly unrelated characters, but as the story unfolds, the connections between them are slowly revealed.
Now, the structure of the story and these gradual revelations are one of the most notable aspects of the film, so we don't want to tell you too much about the plot right now. Suffice to say, it features a rare egg-smuggling pet shop boy. No, not Neil Tennant. A heavily pregnant nightclub owner, played incidentally by Arsine Kanjian, who is Atima Gwyn's longtime partner. And an auditor who is Mr. Businessman by day, but by night he enters the secret world of Exotica to pay out for private dances from the lovely Christine. And Christine is played by Mia Kirshner, who you may remember as the dominatrix in Love and Human Remains.
That's right. Yes, well, they're a disparate bunch of characters, but they all share the common experience of loss and desire.
Oh, beautifully said. Loss and desire.
Did you know her?
Sort of.
She was your neighbor?
I babysat her a couple times.
Oh, so you knew her pretty well, eh?
Yeah, I did. What about you?
Well, I heard this thing was being organized, so... Seems so, surreal, doesn't it?
What?
Did we find anything? I mean, there's so many places we could hide something in this country. My name's Eric.
I'm Christina.
Hey, nice to meet you, Christina.
Well, what?
Don't you want to touch it? You don't have to. It's one of those things people normally like to do.
Ah.
this thing about Eric calling you a sassy piece of jailbait?
What's this thing?
Bothers me.
Why?
Makes you act like a child or something.
I'm like the tartan skirt in my socks or the blouse of the way I act, right?
You find it strange that you would still want to work here?
Zoe, not all of us have the luxury of deciding what to do with our lives. It's a job and he's getting paid all right.
I just find it cruel.
So fire him.
Oh, what a shame they cut it to a fair girl is, because if they'd waited just another couple of moments, you could have seen the one dyke bit in the film. And it's certainly not very often we see heavily pregnant gals puckering up for other gals on our cinema screens. In fact, takes me back to the glory days of Il Futuro e Donna, when the beautiful Ornella Muti played the beauty with the bump, and Hannah Sigler played the lucky recipient of those.
That's all
snuggy, yummy
very, very interesting. But maybe, I mean, neither of these women are in this film, so maybe we should look at the performances in Exotica.
Oh, all right then. Sounds suitably chastened. Yes, okay, sorry. After you.
Having said that, I have to say it's very hard to single out one performance in this film. It features great ensemble acting from a very experienced and capable cast. Mm-hmm. Bruce Greenwood is excellent as the auditor with a sad secret and a compulsive behaviour pattern, as is Don McKellar as a pet shop owner with a taste for exotic animals and men.
Oh, like you.
Yeah, just like me, yes. And he also has a predilection for the compulsive, as does Bruce Greenwood. And he spends most of his time at the opera looking for love amongst the artists.
What's this machine? It's an incubator. What's it for? Well, what do you think it's for?
Eggs.
That's right. Are they yours?
What do you mean?
I mean, shouldn't you be sitting on them or something? Oh, yeah, well, I guess I've abandoned the nest. What's inside of them?
The eggs.
Yes.
Well,
Hyacinth macaws, if you want to know the absolute truth.
And where'd you get them? From very far away.
I've said it before and I'll say it again. What is it with these Canadian filmmakers? It really is Queer City over there at the moment. A couple of months ago I asked Patricia Rosenmother whether they're putting something in the water. Everybody seemed to be so bent. There was her film, When Night Is Falling, the Jamie Padeswa film Eclipse, which showed in the film festival and is going to be released here shortly. And later in this show I'll be talking about the first feature from Clement Virgo called Rude, which also has a whole queer segment to it.
Yes, and now here is Adam Ngoyan joining the ranks of Denis Enclin, whose last film was Love and Human Remake.
I rest my case.
There you go. Now, it's also a very exciting industry there at the moment, although recent government funding cuts have put a little bit of a dent in it, apparently. And it's also a very close-knit community. Now, Don McKellar, who plays Thomas, the pet shop boy in the film.
And he's absolutely fabulous.
Yeah, well, anyway, he might be known to audiences as the circus manager, Timothy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who's in When Night Is Falling, and he's also a very accomplished writer-director. He's been involved in projects such as 32 short films about Glenn Gould, Highway 61, Roadkill, and Blue, which featured David Cronenberg.
Mm-hmm. Now, Exotica has done very well overseas. It won the International Critics Prize at Cannes, but the advance word here has been somewhat mixed. Perhaps the themes of grief and sexuality and desire have just been a bit too confrontational for some. What I hear seems to be mostly straight men that are having problems with it, which I wonder what that says. I thought it was a stunning piece. It's absolutely impeccably constructed, and the themes and the ideas and issues resonate long after you've left the cinema, and will probably have a much longer shelf life than that other movie that's out about tap dancing at the moment, Showgirls.
No, wait a minute, you loved Showgirls, didn't you?
Some sort of
Yes, I did, absolutely. I thought it was the Valley of the Dolls of the 90s, and I think Elizabeth Berkeley is the Ruby Keeler of our times. You can think about that one later. But even I would not be stupid enough as to confuse Showgirls with art.
Okay, now, isn't it time you went back to Toronto?
Thank you very much. Nice to see you too. Yes, all right, I will. But before I go, let's have one more plunge into the perverse. Now, in our last program, I told you about the queer content in the Toronto Film Festival, and today I just want to do a quick wrap-up of some of the other highlights, a couple of disappointments, and some of the more quirky bits too. One of the most interesting things I discovered in the first few days of the festival is that even in the ostensibly straight films, there seemed to be the odd queer element just sticking its head up and saying, "Hello, I'm still here." One of the funniest moments for me was during the gala screening of The Grotesque, which is this new English movie starring Alan Bates and Sting. Now, galas are the big nighttime showcase screenings. They have hundreds of people there, and Sting himself was in attendance, surrounded by heaps of adoring female fans who were cheering and sighing at his cheekbones all the way through the movie, until the moment when he actually kissed another male character full on the lips. Mwah, big smacker. Suddenly, you could hear a pin drop, let me tell you. It all went very, very quiet, apart from me chuckling away in the front row. Now also, these queer elements came into a lot of the debut features, notably in a first feature from a Canadian director called Clement Virgo, in a film called Rude, which is actually three stories entwined into one. One of the stories concerns a young gay boxer who during the course of the movie has to confront a lot of internalized homophobia and the prejudices of his gay-bashing boxer buddies. Virgo says that he used this environment specifically to address the issues of masculinity, emotions, and sexuality, as you can't get a much more macho world than that of the boxer. Well, that's true enough. It's a beautifully shot film. The colours in particular are absolutely sumptuous. And as an added bonus for all you gay girlies out there, one of the stories features Rachel Crawford, who you will no doubt remember as the gorgeous Petra from When Night is Falling. Now, personally, the two films I found most disappointing in the festival feature two of my favourite Frenchies. So I don't know if that has something to do with negative karma floating around in the ether, or perhaps it just isn't the best nationality to be right now. First up, there is Aubert Fragile, the new film from veteran director Jacques Rivette, who made the truly wonderful and fairy tale like Céline et Julie vont en bateau way back in 1974. That's Céline and Julie go boating. He's made some fabulous movies since then, and Aubert Fragile continues the usual Rivette tradition of being well over 3 hours long, but this time he just doesn't seem to say anything. He goes round and round in circles, and it's almost as if he's decided to become the new Jacques Demy, the imaginative French director who was responsible for such musicals as Les Parapluies de Cherbourg, The Embers of Cherbourg, and Les Demoiselles de Rochefort. In Rivette's movie, the characters stop and sing sometimes, and they dance, but very awkwardly. There's not a lot of choreography involved, and the plot is wafer thin. And after 2 hours, you're just very bored and wish they'd all stop what they're messing around at and get on with it, whatever it may be. Now, the other big disappointment, I'm afraid, I have to announce, stars our very favourite French gal, Catherine Deneuve, who is as beautiful as ever, of course, but is involved in a complete stinker of a film called The Convent by Manuel de Oliveira. Now, usually he has a policy of not casting big international stars in his movies, but Catherine made the mistake of saying in an interview somewhere that she'd really like to work with him, so he got in touch with her. Now, in the film, her academic husband is played by John Malkovich, and he takes her to visit a secluded convent in Portugal to work on his thesis that Shakespeare was actually Spanish. Not sure about that one, John. The convent's guardian is very Lucifer-like and is always tempting Malkovich or becoming obsessed with Catherine, as you would. In turn, Malkovich soon gets the hots for his beautiful young assistant, and soon everything dissolves into a mess of Faustian pretensions, with the four characters chasing each other around the woods meaningfully. In case you don't get the allegories, we were periodically thumped over the head with bizarre soundtrack effects like which caused a great deal of merriment amongst the audience, but failed to convince us that the movie was filled with any great insight. It's very sub-Bergman, sub-Antonioni, and to top it all, the film actually broke down halfway through the screening, during which period half the audience used that as an excuse to leave. Obviously very glad of that excuse. I stay because Catherine does look stunning, of course, but oh dear, sometimes looks really aren't everything. Okay, moving swiftly on from the downers, let's just talk about the real highlights of the festival. With a brief honourable mention for Heavy, the first feature film from the American director James Mangold. Heavy certainly has its detractors, but I found the attention to detail of life in a small town roadside diner quite remarkable. It features a handful of great performances from a very tight ensemble cast, including Shelley Winters, always nice to see her, and there's an interesting generation gap thing happening with the casting of Debbie Harry as the older waitress and Liv Tyler and a boyfriend played by Evan Dando of the Lemonheads. Now, Harry does a really nice turn as the older jaded waitress, feeling decidedly threatened by the appearance of the lovely Liv, who is currently also on our screens in the very disappointing Bruce Beresford thriller Silent Fall. I must say, it certainly made me feel my age to see that my adolescent heroine, Deborah Harry, was playing second fiddle to this admittedly gorgeous up-and-comer. La Ceremony is the new film by another French veteran director, Claude Chabrol, who thankfully proves he has lost none of his sharpness and wit. Based on a Ruth Rendell psychological thriller, the film stars Sandrine Bonnaire as the maid to a wealthy household headed by Jacqueline Bisset, of all people. She meets the local postmistress, played by Isabelle Huppert, in one of the quirkiest and most delicious performances of her career, and the two quickly form an intense bond, eventually dressing alike and wearing the same hairstyle. It's got shades of Genet's The Maids, and it's a perverse and seductive tale with fairly shocking denouement and great performances all around. From the journals of Gene Seberg is the latest film from Mark Rapaport, who made Rock Hudson's home movies a couple of years ago. His new film is very similar in style to Rock Hudson, in that it uses a look-alike of the star talking about their career over clips of their movies. I think it's a far superior film, though. It's very much more sophisticated and a very clever take on the material. It's extremely witty, painstakingly researched, and a real gem for anybody that loves movies in general, or Gene Seberg in particular. It also does a great job of putting her career in context by examining the parallel careers of other politically motivated female stars like Vanessa Redgrave and Jane Fonda. Now, I know I sometimes exhibit dubious taste in my choice of favourite movies, but I was obviously well in step with the general Toronto populace for my top film of the festival, as it later took out the Audience Award for the most popular film. The film is Antonia's Line, and it's directed by the Dutch feminist filmmaker Marlene Garis. Now, I'm sure you remember her as the maker of those fiercely political but always totally compelling movies from the early 80s, A Question of Silence and Broken Mirrors. She followed those up with the much less successful The Last Island, but has come way back on top form with her fourth film, Antonia's Line. It's already been picked up by New Vision Films, so we'll review it in greater detail when it comes out early next year. Suffice to say, it seems as if Marlene has been mellowing away for the last couple of years. Her feminist stance is as much in evidence as before, but men as a gender are no longer the enemy, merely a few specific examples of them. If there's one word that sums up this whole film, it's heart, which it has in abundance. It's a through-the-generations sort of film that traces Antonia's dynasty from her daughter to her granddaughter to their granddaughters, and it's absolutely beautifully done. It's a totally joyous experience from start to end. Look out for it after Christmas. Now, the musical is a very strange genre. It's something the Americans have got sewn up, but a lot of other countries don't seem to be able to quite get their handle around it. I mean, when was the last time you saw a really good German musical, for example?
What about Das Peace Party?
Well, I think that's the exception that proves the rules, but I think it is. But other countries, when they stick to their own style, like the Indian three-hour blockbusters that every so often the plot will stop and everybody will race off to the nearest plantation and sing a song about the terrible fate of a poor blind woman who was raped by a horrible man with a big black beard until she was saved by Amitabh Bachchan. But other countries don't quite seem to have it as well. The French, of course, can do a good musical as long as they stick to their own particular quirky brand of Gallicness. Le Parapluie de Cherbourg is a good example. But when they try and go for the American big-budget extravaganza stuff, as in Demoiselle de Rochefort, it doesn't quite come off. And the English are the same. Most of the time, they don't go for the big budget things, and it works best when it's small, when it's quirky, when it sort of relies on the English sense of humour, when it's sort of like the Beatles in the Richard Lester films, Help and Hard Day's Night, or when it's like Summer Holiday. In this film,
There is no great choreography, there's no astounding sets and great ideas and fabulous plot and big, big stars. What you've got is four rather charming, chappy guys on the road in a big red bus, picking up three also charming and chappy gals in a little jalopy, taking them to Athens, picking up a few more friends on the way, and boy, learning how to twist.
No, I shouldn't be surprised. That gasket hood looks pulverized. The shocking coil is now reversed. So first you'd boil and then you'd burst. Compression peaks will soon distend. The leak that leaks in your big end. Elastic coker's got a hitch around the choker. Just must switch the fist. The spout is dynamite. And cutting out the parking light. And throttle shake your offside break. Is eating on your drum. In fact, make no mistake. You really had it, chum.
As I've said before, the reason this film works for me is the just all-round good-natured youthful exuberance of the cast. I really wanted to go on that bus with them. Cliff Richard is the star, and he may be no Elvis, but he certainly passes muster as a young juve lead. He sings very nicely, of course, and he also dances not badly at all, thank you very much. And he wears an interesting line in aerated shirts throughout the movie. It's also interesting for those who have speculated on Cliff's life and career in later years that his love interest in the movie for the first part of it is dressed up as a little boy. I just mention it in passing. But he never really went on to have a great career in movies, Cliff. They followed this up with a film called It's a Wonderful Life, and it suffered exactly the fate I was talking about earlier. They tried to make everything bigger and better. There was a bigger budget. They went off to Cairo and had sand and deserts. There was a big star, fairly big star, as his co-star, Suzanne Hampshire, and lots of extras, and it really fell quite flat on its face. It didn't have the spark and originality of Summer Holiday. In later years, he was even reduced to making a musical, yes, a musical, set in Birmingham, England, about the naming of a new hamburger. Ooh, how are the mighty fallen? Okay, it's certainly not Singing in the Rain or On the Town. It's probably not even Xanadu, but as British musicals go, I think it ain't half bad. And if you don't enjoy the music, then at least you can get off on the camp value of seeing Cliff singing about being a bachelor boy, which I think is always worth a good chuckle or two.
But until then, I'll be a bachelor boy, and that's the way I'll stay. Happy to be a bachelor boy until my dying day.
Next up, The Young Poisoner's Handbook.
O'Reilly, Fred, what the devil have you put in this tea? It smells all ammonia-y, Dad. Oof.
It smells like grapefruit.
Smells like cat's piss.
Graham! Get your backside in here, now!
Have you been using your mother's cups and saucers for your bloody experiments? Hey, what have I told you?
The Young Poisoner's Handbook is director Benjamin Ross's feature film debut, and it's based on a true story about a teenage boy whose fascination with chemistry soon becomes a deadly hobby when he begins to poison people around him. Madeline spoke to the director when he was in town last week, but she politely refused his invitation to coffee.
The way that you explore evil is by positing it as another. Something trying to get in, and in fact the whole point of this film, the very first decision I made, was that we were not going to do that, nor were we going to tell the story from the psychiatrist's point of view and do a kind of a rational scientist's exploration of this weird other mind like Equus or something, and then they realise it. That's all very conventional for me, and I'm bored with that stuff. I'm not saying it doesn't work or whatever, it's just that it's like I was sick of it and I wanted to do something else. So we decided to make the so-called mad person, the central character, so that your moral barometer would be totally inverted.
The first stage of the experiment had gone to plan. Now there was only one obstacle on my path.
Graham, where's that medicine? Mum's waiting!
Coming!
The prying eyes of my dear sister Winnie.
She's supposed to get two of those.
I know, thank you.
Tell me some more about the casting process, especially Hugh O'Connor.
Yeah, well, I'd known Hugh, not personally, but I'd known his work for a while because I saw him in My Left Foot, and I was very impressed with that. And I was impressed with how much he'd done with so little. You know, he had no dialogue like Daniel Day-Lewis had dialogue. It's the younger Christy Brown. He had no dialogue. He couldn't mime, which is what you normally do when you don't have dialogue. But he couldn't mime because only his left foot was working. So it's like you set an actor the most difficult task. How do you create emotion and communicate and act when you can't take away all his tools? And he did it. And he did it because he realised instinctively that screen acting is about the eyes.
What did you use for puke? Or is that a trade secret?
Well, yeah, I'd keep that under wraps personally. But I'll say that it's different each time.
So and
I'm different in colour, different consistency, as it indeed it is in life. I'm very concerned to get those details right. And I designed it essentially myself. I take a personal interest in design details like that.
Although I enjoyed watching The Young Poisoner's Handbook, it's got great production and design, and visually it's a very interesting film. It also features some really fine performances, especially from the lead, played by Hugh O'Connor. There was something lacking in the film, and I couldn't help feeling coming out of it that it was a little bit of a hollow experience, and some of the humour in it just doesn't come off. It ends up being quite nasty. Now compare how the protagonist's mother is portrayed in this film to how Peter Jackson deals with the mother of the two girls in Heavenly Creatures, and you'll see what I'm saying. Basically, it's a bit of a hollow experience, and I was just left feeling I wanted more, so I'm going to give it a 6.5 out of 10.
Well, that's it for this show, I'm afraid, and for this season. I've got to be off the air, off your screens for a couple of months, off having a 2-month-long party, but look out for Shorting Out, which is a new program coming up on Bent very shortly. We'll be back for a Christmas special, hopefully, and then we'll be back on your screens proper in the new year. But until then, look after yourselves, see lots of movies. I'm Madeline Swain.
And I'm Spiro Kramopoulos.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
All worries for me or you, for a week or two. We're going where the sun shines brightly, we're going where the sea is blue. We're seeing it on the movies, now let's see if it's true. Everybody has a summer holiday, doing the things they always want to do. So we're going on a summer holiday to make our dreams come true. For me and you, for me and you, for me.